Whatever fun is to be gotten out of pornography surely is to be gotten out of reading it and not in hearing lectures about it. So I can't promise that this lecture will be as exciting as its title may suggest. And I hope it won't be exciting in that way, because then I won't be able to say what I want to say. I will try to define what I mean, characterize it. My classical, I should say, really, the title's a kind of joke. By classical, I just mean not 42nd Street. I mean things which have some claim to our interest as part of culture as opposed to sociology or journalism. So I'm going to think of as my examples when I'm talking. I'm not going to characterize anything in detail because I assume that's not necessary. Books like De Sade, anything from De Sade, or anything else of that period, D'Inertia, some great long volumes that were written in France in the 18th century. By Colbert, and I suppose we can think of things like candy if you want to. I'll explain what I mean by pornography in a moment, but first of all, the adjective in the title just means something having to do with literature in some way, or art in some way, as opposed to it's strictly commercial or sleazy product. I mean classical. Now, what do I mean by pornography? That's more important. I don't mean eroticism or art that has to do with the erotic. I want to perhaps rather arbitrarily propose a definition of pornography, of what is pornographic, or what the pornographic spirit is, or that type of consciousness which produces works of art that could be called pornographic. I know my definition will be seem to some of you arbitrary, and I make no defense of it except to say that it works for me, or to say certain things that I want to about the theme under discussion in these five lectures. Therefore, I do not mean simply works of art dealing with the erotic or the sexual. I will rather arbitrarily define pornography as works of art which embody the idea that lascivious or lustful acts or thoughts are inherently immoral. I don't know whether I ought to repeat that or not, because I know it's a bit of a turn on the usual definition. In other words, I'm not saying pornography is immoral. I'm saying pornography, by pornography I mean works of art which embody or reflect or react to or react against the idea that lustful or lascivious acts and thoughts are immoral. In other words, works of art which directly and without consciousness of a moral judgment against sexual behavior, works of art which without that consciousness embody or depict sexual behavior, I do not consider as pornography in this definition. That includes, say, Balinese dancing or certain Indian temple sculpture, and also I think some works of art in the Western tradition, although unfortunately there are very few works of art in our culture which do not embody or reflect or react against the idea that there's something immoral about sexual behavior. That's what I mean by pornography. Now, I want to begin by referring or recapitulating some themes in the discussion last week about comedy, the features of comedy that I singled out as relating to the theme of the impersonal, the idea of underreacting, disparity between an understated feeling deadpan, the idea of there being a character who is a kind of still center in the midst of outrage. And to that notion, I want to ask, add one more thing. It was mentioned to me by somebody after the lecture last Monday. Somebody said that I hadn't taken account of slapstick, for instance, in accent comedies. I think that what I was saying does apply, can include slapstick, because slapstick, this tremendous movement and physical abuse of characters by each other, seems to me to have the same effect as the principle of the deadpan. It's just the deadpan in another register. One neutralizes emotion by making it perpetual, by driving it on in the same intense horizontal way. I think that when you see Buster Keaton, for instance, like the Navigator in general, where he is a figure of interpretive events, or see him in some of his earlier movies, shorter films like Cops, where he's running all the time, where he is continually agitated, you see that the principle of continual agitation or perpetual motion in very violent slapstick, and the idea of the deadpan as represented in figures like Keaton and Chaplin most beautifully, really does amount to the same thing. It amounts to the deadening or neutralization of emotion, and further, as I talked about last time, the putting at a distance of the audience's emotions, of the ability to identify in a humanistic way and bring moral judgments and so on about situations of violence. Now, I want to begin today by making what seems to be a very strong and important connection between pornography and the sense in which I've defined it and comedy. It seems to me that this connection can be made in several different ways. First of all, simply in the matter of form. And I'm thinking here chiefly of literary works, as you'll see. The typical form of pornographic writing seems to me parody. De Sade's favorite literary form is clearly parody. He's parodying a certain kind of moralistic fiction. Let's say it's that of Richardson, Pamela, Clarissa, in which virtue triumphs, in which a heroine preserves her virtue amidst the many temptations, or in which, in the case of Clarissa, a blackguard, a cad, a seducer is finally reformed or taught the evil of his ways. Throughout De Sade's hundreds of volumes of books, of plays, essays, and so on, there's a continual awareness, obvious awareness, of other forms of discourse which he sees himself as inverting, as parodying, but he relies, or he evokes in his readers a sense of those forms, whether it's this kind of sentimental novel of Richardson, or whether it's the moralistic discourses on nature of the 18th century philosophes. But all his forms are takeoffs, they're parodies upon already existing forms, and even characters themselves, and they make very obvious reference to these poems in De Sade's narratives. His characters, many of them, they're clearly divided into the virtuous and the wicked. The wicked, of course, always teach the virtuous the folly of their ways. The virtuous characters always pretend to believe in innocence and kindness and in devotion and chastity, and this gives De Sade an opportunity to parody and to ridicule these beliefs. Precisely by allowing characters to mouth them in this very sententious way, he can then parody the beliefs and provide what is a very superficial kind of ideological confrontation in his works. In fact, it's very interesting if you read large quantities of this, how much of the books are taken up with this kind of discussion. discussion of the relative merits of virtue and vice. Lots of other works that can be brought under this label of pornography as either